I'm going to talk about, I'm going to talk about three things. I'm going to talk about, the session title was about using data to grow your business. But actually, we all know that data doesn't grow businesses, customers grow business. So we're going to talk about customer loyalty, how you can use data to understand your customers and be relevant, and then how to derive from data insights that you could move to action, that you could do something about to grow your venture. I tried to go around and just get a sense as to where everybody was coming from and that sort of thing. So those are the three things that I'm going to talk about. I'm going to try and kind of whip through this in about 20 minutes or so, so that we can then really happy to dive deeper on anything that anybody's interested in. But given that you're all coming from different places, I figured that'd be the way to make it most relevant. And as we go through, most of the examples I'm going to give are from our work with mobile operators. So what Citizen Insight does is we partner with mobile operators, and we also work a bit in the retail and the financial services space, so I'll bring in some other examples, but most of the work, the data work that we do in examples are with cell phone companies, so I'll use that. So the first thing is about your customers engaged. I think what we really want to think about is preference, that instead of loyalty, you're asking for people who will choose you from a range of options in an area more of the time. So this is like recurring preference, and that we kind of think of as commitment. So as opposed to loyalty, to think about it as commitment. And obviously that, so this idea of repeat business, for the mobile operators we work with, that has to do with, you know, how often and what kinds of bundles people, you know, kind of top up and use their services. For people who provide food as a business, right? It's about how what the frequency is and how many items you choose. If you're a store or a product, you know, physical location, it's about the size of your basket and how often people come to you. It's that kind of repeat business. That's what you're sort of looking for. So this whole notion of loyalty, I was kind of looking and thinking about loyalty. When we do kind of longer form, kind of like executive sessions on this, we ask if everybody can see in the light. That's a big Harley Davidson tattoo. So this is like what absolute customer loyalty looks like. It's where people take your product or your service and they like put it on their body. It doesn't happen very often. There's only, you know, kind of a few exceptions. I've racked up like VW, Nike, Apple, these kinds of things where people, for whatever reason, are taking on loyalty to you or your product or your service, in the exception of considering anything else because it's part of their identity. That's like this percent of the world's population and therefore not really a good basis for a business growth strategy. So going back to this idea of recurring repeat business and commitment, so the value of a committed customer. So if loyalty doesn't exist and it's about repeat business, we do a lot of work kind of understanding in what sectors, how valuable are your committed customers versus the efforts that you try to attract new customers. So in the mobile space, it ranges differently in markets. It's roughly about 12 to 20 times. So it takes 12 to 20 new customers or on and off customers to replace the value of a lost committed customer. And so if you're talking about sort of growing your business and going to that sort of repeat business and growing from, you really want to be thinking about loyalty in relation to people who are already demonstrating a commitment to you or your product. The tricky thing is, in order to understand the needs of a customer and what it is that they're wanting from you or getting from you, there isn't an average customer. But we're going to talk about segmentations in a sec, but traditionally, people, when they think about customers or user groups, whether that's in the NGO sector or whether that's in the commercial space, you kind of take people into, you know, 5 to 10, maybe 12 groups, and you put a little headshot on top of a slide and you put a little description of them. Everybody's kind of seen that, kind of user groups or segmentations. And the problem is that that doesn't really work because we all know that we're made up of way more characteristics than the little bits that sit underneath those sort of headshots. So if there's no average customer, if you're trying to get repeat business, in order to do that, you need to understand what customers want. And if there's no average customer, that's where data comes in, right? So you need to get data in order to understand what it is that customers want and need. So these, based on our experience working with lots of different sectors, are the kinds of questions that, in kind of simple terms, that we think you have to make as a business in order to be relevant. I'm happy to give everybody this information if you want to save and take a picture. So this is all stuff that I hope everybody would sort of recognize, right? It's, you know, it's like you need a balance of prices that work for you and good promotions. You need the right range of products for your customers. new products and service developments. You need to, very importantly, staying aware of customers' changing needs. These are the kinds of questions that you need to answer, and therefore you need to go and get data on, right, in order to be able to answer that. This to wrap up this section on loyalty so we can get onto the data bit, is that I guess we think that that customers, even at the very bottom of the pyramid, are going through a process of having choice and options, as demonstrated by the community who are here at Sankalp in terms of people who are trying to reach them with stuff. Those of us who are customers at the higher end of the kind of income to social income spectrum are super empowered and loads of choice. And therefore, in order to grow your business, it's all about relevance and all about using data. So what we're going to do next is talk about what kinds of data do you use in order to understand what is relevant for our customers, right? So that's the customer loyalty point. I'm happy to go back on any of that stuff if people are interested. So there's a lot of talk about the data. I'm not going to talk about just, the eons and eons of data warehouses that sit out there. I'm going to talk about the part of data that's useful for understanding your customer and for growing your customer base. So just as a quick starting point, you guys probably can't read this, but so basically at the bottom it says census data. So this is the kind of inception of where kind of lots of big behavioral data comes from. So there's this kind of census data all the way up to everything being GPS located, lots of social and search data. And in the middle, we started to have access to purchase data and credit data and lifestyle lists. There were those things. I don't know if anybody remembers yourself or anybody in your family getting like catalogs that were based on some one thing you did, which meant you were part of this lifestyle kind of brand. So this is like the evolution of where big data comes from. And it really has been a shift. And this, I think, goes very much for customers who are buying products and services as much as service users of NGO programs, to another couple of people who are here looking at that. This kind of focus on people are stuck where they live and how, we used to get big behavioral information that came out every year, and it's kind of moved up through you are what you buy, we understand people through the kinds of things that they're acquiring, and that's how we understand people. And now there's this, you can follow my life through the behavioral data where I was talking with a couple of people who've now moved around the kind of information that you have, even from your SMS warranty and insurance stuff, can tell you a lot about sort of people, and you can track people and their behavior in that. Interestingly enough, I think the stats are, it's like 45 zigas, I don't remember the name of the biggest byte. There's a huge amount of data out there. Only about a half of 1% actually gets used or analyzed. And I think that that's something that is relevant and hopefully liberating for anybody who's thinking about data. Is it's not about wrapping your arms around lots of stuff. It's about making really specific choices about what kinds of data will help you understand your customer. So this is just for anybody who's interested. Again, I can share this, like types of big data sources. I wrapped up the elephant because it seemed more interesting to me than the kind of circles. But basically, every action in the world creates data nowadays. And so that's where kind of all the layers come from. The thing for all of us to think about in relation to our businesses, can't see with the lights, this is a dark continent of Africa picture, and it says on there, big data is useless by itself. So it's basically about saying, what are the business problems that I'm trying to solve, and what data do I need in order to solve that? And that's a really key. There is a ton of effort, money to be won and lost by misallocating or being careful or careless with using data or trying to use data. You can send yourself down huge rabbit holes. One of my favorite big data, just to kind of bring it to life, so I remember in like 2013, there was that fake AP press tweet about the White House being bombed and President Obama being, and there were a bunch of financial trading houses who had algorithms focused on big data models, and they picked that up and they started selling stocks, and the Dow Jones went down like 143 points in like 50 seconds or something like that. And it was basically a classic example of not being thoughtful about what data you're using to make the choices and what business problems you're trying to solve. So the key question is, what data can I use that can help me understand my customers so that I can be relevant for them, right? So I'm going to use, there were a couple of people who said, I'm working with teams who are not very data savvy, and so the next little bits are about the kind of frameworks that we use in order to engage clients that we work with who are not very data savvy, so hopefully it's helpful for you. So this is a basic transaction flow that we use for our understanding customers and kind of
simple terms. So basically, people's attitudes inform their motivations or the drivers of their behavior, which informs their behaviors, which turns into transactions for you, which is where you get your revenue from, right, your profits. There are data sources underneath all of these that you can focus on. We have a really strong bias towards behavioral data, which is what I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking on. So you can go out and get people's attitudes, right, in surveys and that sort of thing. You can go out and literally watch what people are doing and get their behaviors. And obviously, you can look at your till or your, you know, kind of what's your point of sale, any data that's about the transactions and your profits. So there are data sources underneath all of these. We think that focusing on the behavior in the middle is the most rewarding. So just to cover off, most businesses focus only on the profit side. They're coming from what makes me the most money and how do I analyze that and figure out how to do more of that. The problem with this in relation to customers and them choosing you again and again and again is this is thinking about it from your side, not from the customer side, right? So it's like well-intended, but it ends up with you not being relevant for your customer and them not choosing to come back. The like classic example is, say you run a shop where you sell refrigerators or electronic goods, some big like white goods kind of thing, and somebody comes in once in 2 years and buys a TV or a refrigerator for a lot of money, and you got another customer who comes in over 2 years, 9 or 10 times, and they spend half the money buying lots of different things. And most businesses focus on the profits, and so they go after that single client. And the problem with that is that person's needs are sorted, and they're not likely to come back to you, and they're not going to choose anything again. Whereas the person who's coming to you on a regular basis, if you start to pay attention to their behaviors, you'll see that there's a bigger opportunity to engage your customers. And that's like a classic mistake that even really big, very sophisticated businesses make. So the second thing that people do is the kind of very traditional kind of market research. They come at it from an attitude point of view. And it's very difficult to take people's attitudes, so what I just say about what I think about something, and trace that all the way through to how you make money off of that. It's also really impossible to get attitudes for everybody, so it's done usually with kind of small samples, as opposed to looking at everybody and each of your customers and how you can be relevant for them. So you get a small sample, and it leads you by nature into these small group segmentations, and then trying to communicate with your customers in like 8 or 9 groups or types. The other thing is that there's a big difference between what people say they do and what they actually do, right? So I'm sure you can come up with a lot like, if you were to ask somebody, how often do you call your mother, right? And then you ask the mother, how often do you get called? You probably get 2 different answers, and neither one of those would actually be the real answer. Where, funny enough, if you go, in our case, if you go and look at the CVR records off of somebody's mobile phone, you can answer that question more definitively, right? So this issue of attitudes giving them incorrect stuff. So the reason why we focus on behavioral data, and I think this goes for people who are looking at like gender dimensions in water and sanitation programs to, you know, the most commercial of activities, is that you have data on what your customers do with you, so you have it for you to get some kind of understanding of all of your customers, and therefore to treat them individually in a nuanced way that they need to be, because everybody is individual, right? So that's a really big thing that behaviors does that attitudes and kind of traditional market research doesn't do. And the second thing is it leads you to respond to what people really do, when they do it, where they do it, which is sound information that you can build on. These are the kinds of questions that we ask, we don't pay attention to the detail, to understand that behavior. So it's like, what do they do? How do they do it? Why do they do it? You know, who matters most in terms of who is influencing groups of customers, for us? When, if I take examples from our mobile phone work, when people buy, voice and SMS credit bundles, does that affect how much data they buy, right? So that, like, there's a classic, like, behavioral question. I can get data on it, and I can answer that against a specific business problem, right? There are, sort of what times people buy. People who buy and top up their phones or their mobile money accounts between 6 and 8 in the morning are probably commuting or taking kids to school, right? And so I can respond by thinking about the customer experience they have in that long queue at the agents on the corner outside their house, and if I can solve that, they're more likely to choose me, right? So that this is that within behavioral data stuff. The last thing, I guess, just to show you kind of how we do this in our business, which is relevant for some people, we use this thing called customer dimensions. So we take all of the those questions that we're trying to answer, like are people price sensitive? Are they social? Like, you know, does Marion have lots of contacts or a few contacts? Does she move around a lot? You know, these are the kinds of questions, and we have these about 30 or so of these dimensions, these spectrums of behavior, which describe the DNA of a person and who they are beyond just their relationship to me and the product that they're buying. And then, and each of those spectrums is a cluster of indicators based on the data, the behavioral data that I have. And then in essence, you can run your data as it comes through that, and each one of, you know, the kind of biggest, you know, kind of mobile operators you're working with have about 9, 10 million customers, and you're getting individual profiles on every single one of them, so that when you reach out, you're figuring out that the person who is price sensitive, but who, sorry, I'm just pointing to you because you're in the front row, Marion, who is price sensitive, but who has a large, like, social network, and she tends to communicate on that, like, Friday night and Saturday night, and that's a real hub and spoke person, and so if I give her offers that are really attractive for her to pass on to her friends, she's going to love me because I'm putting her at the center of her social network, and her friends are going to love her because, right, so that, these are just, like, picking out a couple of those spectrums and trying to respond to it, right? So different from the classic segmentations where you go out and you ask a sample of people and you put people into a few kind of buckets and it's static, and you have to like kill yourself as a customer to get from the fourth bucket to the third bucket. You never move, right? But in fact, what our lives and our the customers and the people we serve are constantly moving and constantly changing, and the nuance of how you know, where they are and what they care about is changing, like, obviously daily. We can't hope to capture it at that level, but like weekly, monthly, we probably can hope to capture that if you're interacting with it a lot. So that's, this is the kind of, hopefully take you from like big data down to the kinds of data that are useful for understanding how to be relevant for your customers, right? So that behavioral data and how we work with it in the mobile phone space. So, and this second bit, I'm just gonna talk you through the framework of how we move from those insights, like what I said about Marion, to actions in a business, which again, a lot of people have a hard time where they get a bit of data, they play with it, and they go, oh, this is really interesting, and then they go, what do I do with this, right? So this is a really good framework for engaging teams around how you use data with your business. So this is the data value chain that we use. So basically, you need customer data. This is the first kind of, every customer action generates data, right? And you, as we said, you want to focus on the data that reveals behavior at a pretty granular level so that you can understand what people are doing and why. From that data, you can enable insight. So that's the, I see that this person is here at this time and this is what they're doing, right? So that helps you understand your customer's behavior and motivation and focus on insights that you can take actions based on, right? The example I gave with Marion was, you know, exactly that. From the insights, you then have to deliver services that respond and show that you're being relevant to your customers, and from that, your business grows, you get more market share, you get sort of that one more choice, one more time, more often a customer is choosing you, and that's how businesses grow. Right? So that, so just to show you really briefly how that looks in our business in the mobile phone space. So the kind of data that we're looking at is like the activity, so the calls, the SMS, the all of that stuff, where you do it, what kind of, in some cases, what kind of handset you're using, what time of day, how, who you're doing it with, connections, how you pay for it, and obviously all the kind of mobile money, your kind of balance transfers and all of that sort of stuff. So that's all the data, and we then layer it over with stuff that we can get publicly used to data, census, all of that kind of stuff. So this is the, that's all the stuff I have to draw on to understand my customers, right? The second thing is about insights. So we already talked about the customer dimensions, these kind of spectrums of people's price sensitivity and sociability, so we do that. We also do a lot of location-based stuff. If you are in a position where you have location-based data, it can be really instrumental, not only engaging your customers, but in making your operations more efficient. So we can do journey mapping, catchment areas. These are like snapshots out of kind of reports that we've done around the location, where are people coming from and going to with that. You can do area analyses. You can imagine you take your kind of like mobile money standing balances and the way that money flows across a community, and mapping that out in kind of cell blocks helps you understand, for example, where to put your agents, right? If you're a mobile phone company, or where to send your loan officers, if you're a bank, or that sort of thing. So that's the kind of insights that we can derive. We then sort of deliver services off the back of those insights. So I won't go through the whole list, but you know, we work with mobile phone companies to to reduce churn, to reactivate users, like all of the kinds of services that you would imagine. Let me give a couple of examples of this, which is more tangible. So this example around the kind of sociable friend share, that's what I talked about you with Marion. So it's making sure that, you know, of say your 10 million customers, you probably got about 20,000 of those, and making sure that all of those people are getting the right offers to pass on to their friends, right? Similarly, somebody like Esther, who you can see based on the way she uses her mobile money platform, is running an informal small business. I know there's a lot of people here who work with people who are trying to run small businesses and women. They very rarely are getting all of the advantages that a formal business gets in terms of B2B services that can be offered over the phone. And so if you identify that behavioral pattern, you can offer them something that will help them grow their business, right? You can offer them preferential terms on you know, kind of credit and all of that sort of stuff through their mobile phone. And so it's making sure that, you know, all customers like that are getting that. We also can service retailers, government, NGOs, aid agencies around where they engage people, where you do your public service announcements, you know, for you know, public health campaigns, because you can look at traffic of different types of people and where they're going, that sort of thing. So that's the, like, that's based on the insights you then deliver those customer services. This is one of our West African operator partners. This was, in essence, everybody gets offers through their mobile phone. So this is the response rate to offers over just less than a 6 month period, where we shifted from basically just them blasting out to segmentations, and they were getting like 6-7% rates, and we're in a very short space of time are now up around kind of 32%, which I think from our point of view shows that we're giving people something that they want, so they're responding to it, right? So based on starting first from who are these customers, what stage of life are they in, what's relevant for them, how can we do something that they'll value, right? And obviously this also means that the mobile operator is making more money. So this is the full chain. So what the results that come out of that, those services then lead to increases in market share, like all the stuff that your executive, you know, group in a business is going to be focused about, your average, you know, revenue, service, lifetime value of a customer, all of that sort of stuff. It also is very significant in terms of looking at your own operation. So it's not just how I communicate with Marion, it's me thinking about the whole experience that she has with us, and I think about what locations does she interact with us in, and, you know, all of that stuff can lead to much more efficient operations, and so you have a downside on your costs as well as increase in your revenue from this stuff. And this, I pulled out for anybody who's doing like retail stuff, I also just mapped out what this customer flow looks like for a retail, you know, we're actually selling products and services from the store. So hopefully on an after lunch hot room, that was, I guess, gives you the headlines of how we approach data. As we look at stuff, I think that and how we go forward. This is obviously changing very rapidly in terms of the tools that are used. Just if anybody's daunted about the idea of wrapping your arms around data, you know, we're working with really big, really dynamic data sets. We're using all open source software. It's like there's definitely easy, there's no technological or technical reason why you can't play around with this stuff, even if you're not a technical person or a technical organization. The things that I would just say as truce to wrap up are, first off, when thinking about data, don't jump into data, start with your customer. So that whole idea of customer first and customer relevance, right? Super important. Second thing is there's no average customer, we talked about this. So as much as you can, look for data that allows you to see the difference between every single one of your customers. Even if you end up with 10 who are actually do form a group, starting by looking at the granular level of each person in the same nuanced way that you know all of your friends and your family are, and treat them like that, will lead you to a different place in how you engage with them and a much more successful relationship. The focus on being relevant, when you choose the data that you're going to try and work with and pay attention to, and therefore the stuff you're not going to pay attention to, try and get to behavioral data. Attitudinal data and profit data is great to add in, but try and make sure that you're looking at behavioral data. And that the kind of true customer centricity and that real focus requires you to not just think about the marketing campaign or how you communicate, but every aspect of a customer's experience with you. And try and use data to inform that. So if I have locations, it's about the when and how people are interacting and buying my stuff can inform what the design of my store, my mobile point of sale, whatever that is. So, was there. 20 minutes, 24 minutes, sorry. Are there any immediate questions that people would like to ask?
What's the difference between data-related and attitudinal data?
Yeah, so attitudinal data is what you tell me that you do, or what you say that you say that you think about something.
Okay.
And behavioral data is what you actually do. So the kind of big differences in this are, the one is the value of it. So I kind of mentioned the idea about when, how often you call your team, which we're going to talk about in a sec. But traditionally, it is not possible to get attitudinal data on your entire customer base, whereas you can get behavioral data on your entire customer base. So if you start with attitudinal stuff, you end up going, you're one type of customer, you're another type of customer, you're another type of customer, and you end up treating people in blocks.
But then wouldn't you miss trends?
Sorry?
Wouldn't you miss trends? Because behavioral data tends to be in the past. Attitudinal might be over the future.
Yeah, so you do miss trends at the beginning, because you know, if I've only got 2 or 3 months of data, it's hard. When I start to get out sort of beyond like a year, you actually can do kind of future of behavior. Does that mean you catch everything you predict the future and you're Nostradamus? No. Can you look at how small groups of behavioral patterns change and emerge and grow in an entire customer base? Absolutely. That does take a fair bit. That's less a like get yourself a free Tableau license and whack a bunch of data in and see how it visually plots out, which is an easy thing to take a spreadsheet, dump it in, and see what it visually tells you. That's the kind of thing that you probably do need a bit of data science and kind of maths and expertise to do. You definitely have to make sure that it's legal to collect, right? So that's it. So the premise of your question is that anytime you're engaging with data that is from an individual person, there are, so we have, for example, a what we call a citizen data charter, which is about, which talks about the kind of best practice in kind of privacy protection and so on and so forth. So with every person, if we're going to a company and they've got a bunch of data on you as a customer, right? So you have, by accepting the terms of service, you have agreed for them to hold data on you. It's how they process your bills or, you know, kind of do your credit and that sort of thing. Before, what we do is, before we engage with any of the data, we anonymize it all. So this part of the kind of best practice in this is to make sure that you, what's called irrevocable anonymization, so that you not only take out any personally identifiable attributes, but you make it so that you can never reverse analyze the data back to a specific individual person. Because what we're looking at here is we're not, while I'm talking about thinking about an individual customer, you're dealing with groups of people, and so you have a system of interacting with data that allows for the right stuff to get to the right people, but I'm never thinking about or analyzing an individual person. So the key things around sort of legality are, and this is something that's really important for people working in an African environment, the data legislation and policy environment here is less mature than it is in, for example, you know, Europe is probably the most kind of nuanced and sophisticated, North America, obviously, for those of you who are into state surveillance and stuff, there's all kinds of other problems in that sort of way, but that's starting to catch up in Africa. So for those of you who work in a Kenyan context, you know that there is a data privacy bill that's sadly been tabled for about 2.5 years in Parliament. African Union has got kind of consensus, you know, it's kind of based on roughly the European standards of kind of privacy and stuff. And so all of that, we feel like part of our mission as a company is to try to establish a norm for interacting with data from customers that's about delivering things that are valuable to them while respecting their privacy, you know, obviously top shelf data security and making sure that you know, you're encrypted end to end and nothing can be spilled with people's personal data and that kind of thing. So that the answer to your question is how we know that the data we have is legal.
Well, yeah, I actually meant how companies know that
So it's a good question. So some people have terms and conditions, and there's an actual, you know, kind of implicit agreement. At the moment, when you say legal, I think you need to distinguish between legal and like more ethical. Because at the moment, there's not a lot that is illegal just to be really clear, in most markets there is the kinds of things that you would be, could potentially like blur the line, but even in most African markets there is not specific legislation about this, is about taking personally identifiable information, so like name, address, you know, email, phone number, that kind of information, and sharing that with somebody else without the consent of the customer. So that's one thing you definitely need to be thoughtful of and careful about. And the second is about data sovereignty, so it's about moving data outside of national borders, which there are starting to be countries adopting policy frameworks that are not, I don't think it's necessarily the right direction, but they're starting to introduce policy that's trying to protect data by imagining some kind of like national boundaries. Those are the two things that you as a startup really need to think about, and think about how you engage with your customers. There's also, I think, when you are working with a third party, like a company like ours or an enterprise, is about what is the agreements that you have in place around disclosure. So, you know, if you have agreement with your users to be able to collect data, you also need to have really tight agreements with people who are working with your data to not be able to share it with other people. I think you probably noticed in here, I didn't mention a single company or anything of any specificity. The agreements that we work with our clients with, in essence, prevent me from sharing or talking about any of that, because it's about, I mean, but if you think about actually customer loyalty and customer first, the first responsibility you have is to, when you're dealing with data, is to be ethical and responsible for customers' data, right? That's the first responsibility you have. So as a startup, those, I would say the two things to look out for is sharing personally identifiable information and moving data across borders, but you should go to your National Communications Commission and ask what the policy framework is. I can tell you in Kenya, there basically isn't one yet. It, you can go read the draft bill and you can see what's coming, but there isn't a legislative framework. Does that answer your question? Yeah, if you have particular circumstances for your enterprise and you want to come afterwards to have a chat about that, I'd be really happy to. You tell me the nature of the kind of data you have and the kind of customers you have, I'd be really happy to. Any other immediate questions on that? Cool. So we're going to shift from what is relatively like a 25,000-30,000 foot perspective on data and customer loyalty and stuff to Lewis is going to talk to us about his company and how they very efficiently and tactically use technology to engage with customers and get data from them. Right. So we're what we were talking about is working with data that you already have or that you can get, and this is about generating useful data. Good.
My name is Lewis Majanja, and I'm CTO and head of product at Wasabi. So what I do today is just briefly describe what we do and do a quick demo to show you how businesses can use the tools that we have. And I'm sure there are other tools in the marketplace that you can use to collect the same data and make decisions. So at the basic level, what we do is surveys. I mean, asking customers about their level of satisfaction with the product and what is driving their level of satisfaction, because we believe that that information is very helpful to business, whether small or large. And what we do is make a technology that allows you to do this so that it's accessible to small businesses or large businesses. So one important thing about business is listening to what your customers are talking about, you know, understanding what your customers like and their level of satisfaction. Because if you have satisfied customers, they're likely to repeat and come back and talk about the business. If you have satisfied customers, they're unlikely to talk positively, in fact, grow away business from your business. What I'm going to do is just create a quick survey and get some live data to show you what you can do with the tools that we have and other tools that are in the marketplace. So let me just give you a quick demo. This is just a sample dashboard of what we have. So what we do with businesses is integrate customer feedback loops using SMS. So if you go to maybe a retailer and buy an item, you get a survey to rate the service and give a reason for the rating, why you rate the service in that particular way. So in real time, a business gets feedback and is able to see what is going on. Most businesses are single location, small enterprises, so the information they get, you know, there's still a point where they can interact with their customers one-on-one. But as they grow, they have more locations. It becomes very difficult to understand what is going on in different locations. So our tool using SMS, we're able to integrate surveys into transactional processes, whether it's a loyalty card, whether it's a M-Pesa payment, you're able to have this. This is an example of what our dashboards look like. So this is just, again, sample data. This is what it look like. It will look like it will be real-time, and you'll be able to measure real-time customer satisfaction. And that would enable you to either get back to your customers or decide, okay, there's a problem here that you know needs to be resolved. And once you start getting off this data, the customer data, you're also able to detect trends. Technology is moving very fast, so that now you're able to get applied tools of natural language processing. So you can start seeing what customers are talking about. You know, about units, for example, they could be complaining about fresh product, or bad service. You're able to start seeing what people are talking about in real time, trends, and you know, you can also actually separate what the subjects they're talking about, or even their how they describe the services. So you can, because of technology, natural language processing tools, you're able to take that data and in real time be able to detect what people are saying about your services. So what I'm going to do again is just give you a demo of live data collection. And to do that, I'm going to have to get you guys involved in this. So this is our platform. When you log in, this is what you see. We have all kinds of surveys going on. Some surveys could be tied to transaction. This is just a sample account, sample surveys that I have. So today evening we're going to do, a survey. And I'm going to ask you, is there something that you want to find out about consumers in Kenya? We can ask them questions today and get data right away.
Where do you do your shopping?
Sure. Okay, so what I'm going to do is just create the survey. So it's going to call it Sankalp demo. And let's say for the sample, we'll target 100 people in the country, which is Kenya. And for anybody who answers this survey, we'll give them a small incentive, which is Airtel. So just give you a brief background. We have a panel of close to 50,000 Kenyans who've signed up on our panel to give feedback. And in return, they get Airtel incentive. You can get an Airtel incentive, or you can get you can donate that equivalent amount to charity. So, but most people choose Airtel. So, for this demo, we're going to give 30 shillings Airtel, and we're going to select 100 people. So, first question is where do you do your shopping? There's different ways you can do this. You can make this open-ended, or they can just tell you anything that comes to mind. Because when you have open-ended questions, you don't know what people are going to say, and also how people interpret that question is very open. So where do you do your shopping? Somebody can give you an actual location of they can tell you Nakuma, they can tell you Uchumi, or they can tell you I go to the market, or I buy online. So you'll get all kinds of questions, answers. So let's create a question. Where do you...
Be more specific, which supermarket do you do your shopping in?
Okay. So what we can do is ask the question, where did you do shopping? And probably give a few options, supermarket, market. And if they ask for supermarket, then we can branch it off and say, which supermarket you shop at? And then give them options, for example, or leave it open. So let's do, how about in your families, where do you prefer to do shopping? And then the type of question is, you can have multiple choice questions or open ended. And I'd say, let's make this multiple choice. Say, options, kiosk, supermarket, markets. What other options are there? Let's say online, and let's say other, just in case there's an option out there. And if they choose supermarket, we can branch off to supermarket options. So option is good. What options do you need? If they talk to me. What if you make it? Which supermarket did you shop at last time?
So, there are multiple choices.
Documents? And people say other we can actually do a follow-up question. Okay, so we have three questions. And I'll go ahead and send this out to our panel. So I'll just select Kenya general population. It's a panel of 15,000 people. So the survey is good. The controller is going to select 100 people randomly out of the 15,000 in terms of the survey. These are people who signed up on our platform to get these questions. And we've been able to segment them by location, gender, age, and income. So I'll send this out.
Ask questions
in
or you want them after the presentation?
Oh, you can ask them. You can ask. I already said about the survey, so.
No, it's not about the survey. I was wondering how you, because I do a lot of market research.
Yeah.
It's always very hard to find people in like lower income target groups. Like, how do you verify or make sure that your panel is sort of wealthy and you have like all the different income groups represented?
So that's a very interesting question, because a lot of people ask us, since a lot of people are asking about the high income. When people come to us, they ask about the high income group. But the low income, we actually do have an on-ground activation, so we go to different parts of the country, different locations, and actually engage people on the ground and get them registered. So we've been to almost all 47 counties, except mostly the northern part of Kenya, but we actually go on the ground, engage people, and once people experience it, and they do a survey, and they get their airtime, they tell their friends, so it grows viral.
But they don't do it online, right?
No, it's on mobile phone. Actually, if you have a phone with you, are you in Safari?
At the moment,
you don't have a phone. But it happens, technology is SMS-based. So any phone, anybody with a phone can do a survey. You don't need any application, you don't need any app download. As long as you have a phone, you can participate in a survey. So if I chose in the panel, I would select, I could send to only females, and I'd select 18 to 24 age group. Or I would say, I want to compare 18 to 24 and 35 to 44, And then also select the region, and say, only one people in Nairobi. So you're able to target all this. Now we go out and recruit on the ground, and we get different age groups. So. It's actually very easy to get the young age group. The most difficult age group to get is the older and more affluent group that are harder to engage, because there are people who have many options, and as a percentage of the population is low.
And then I have another question. Say if you're after like the older people, then do you kind of balance that out? So then older people kind of like have less access to mobile phones or whatever. So if you recruited less older people in 50,000, do you account for that?
I understand the question. Okay, so when you send out a survey, you're able to decide, okay, this is the sample that I require. You know, so in a database, in our audience, we have, for example, 15,000 active people. You might only require like 100 people between the age of 18 to 40, and you might need maybe 20 people. So there are algorithms that you can do that so that you can actually get the group that you want. So there's enough older people with mobile phones that you're able to get information from. Now, if you look at the statistics on mobile in Kenya, you'll find that I think the last statistics that CAK shared was that around 88% of the population in Kenya has a mobile phone. Now, if you look at the adult population, it's about 95%. So there's going to be some outliers, either the very old or very poor, who don't have a mobile phone. But most economically active Kenyans do have a mobile phone.
Louis, can people bring you their own data? So like if I have 10,000 users or customers or something, and I have their phone numbers, can I bring that to you and do a survey with my own customers on the platform?
Yes, you can do that, but you always require that there's been some type of agreement, consent between your customers and yourself that you can use that information. Because, again, if you're trying to collect information and you spam people, you're not going to get any information. So there has to be a level of consent, a level of familiarity between you and the person you're trying to collect information for. So I just sent out a survey to 100 people about less than a minute ago. And already 55 people have responded. Think about if you wanted to get this sample size, if you wanted to get these answers today in a traditional setting, think about the logistics you'd have to undertake. One, get a team, get them clipboards, educate them, then send them out of the ground. And then when the data comes in, you're not even sure that these are actual people who filled in this form. Somebody could have just gone under a tree. These are all individual people who have responded to this sample. And these are the results. So I guess the majority of people say they prefer to do shopping or supermarkets. And those who like supermarket, the majority prefer chose to shop at government. So you can just refresh this. So, I mean, you already have a 64% response rate. Yes. I don't know which other technology can give you a response. But this is an example of an on-demand survey, in the sense that I wanted some data, I logged in, created a survey. But this is not the only way you can collect data. You can integrate surveys into business processes. So if, for example, you're a retailer, you can integrate a feedback into the M-Pesa payment. Once somebody pays for M-Pesa, you can trigger a survey. Or you can trigger a survey based on customer service calls. If somebody calls a call center and after the call ends and presumably the problem has been resolved, you can send a survey one to get to measure if the customer's issue was satisfied and get their rating, how they rate the service. And also, and based on how they rate, you can follow up the question and say, why? You know, if they gave you a 5, I said, why did you give me a 5? And they will tell you. So traditional people have this long survey where they say, do you like onions? Was the attendant? Cashiers? So these are long questions, but you only need to ask 2 questions. One, please rate our service, and why did you rate that one? That will give you all the information you need to know about that particular service. It just depends on the context. So this is a panel. These are people who opted into a panel, who say, yes, this sounds like fun, sign me up, and I'll do a survey when you send it to me. Then you have businesses, which is transactional. In transactional surveys, you get about 20-30%, with about 70% completion. Of those people who respond, you get about, because it's normally just 2 questions. those people who respond normally get about 60% completion rate. But if you did a survey to anonymous group of people, you only get about 3%. So we don't do that. We don't encourage that. We don't do that. Which one? So you can actually do something like select what frequency to be able to get what other supermarkets are out there. So for example, we have people that came up, salt and whatever that is. But you're able to do, well, once you start getting this data, there's a lot of interesting things you're able to do with this, data. And then, again, like I said, we send this to a panel. So we're able to get the gender information, regional information in terms of where people live, the age, and the location. So I could decide, let me find out what the women, well, the women prefer to shop. So I can filter that, and it seems Tuskies and Nakumans. So I guess we can infer that many things, like the pricing and the location. And if I filter for the male, Nakumans seems to be dominant. So anyway, this is a tool that any business, small or large, we work with small businesses, from women selling cakes to telcos dealing with 40 million customers. So this is a tool that's accessible, technology that's accessible to any level of business.
We don't have to use the last 15 minutes or so, but I'm just curious, did anybody come here with a specific data challenge that you're thinking about, or a specific like data that you're trying to work with, or some challenge that you're trying to figure out, how do I solve this so that I can grow my venture, my business? Because obviously we've got two different complementary perspectives, just so you know, like we partner, so we work together. So has anybody got like a real thing that you've been thinking about and you want to throw out and see if we can play with it?
Yeah. So you're trying to tell us a little bit more about
your... it's a partner organization that has a large Facebook following and aims to, and successfully does interact with customers on Facebook, and then a lot of them do become customers, but increasing the amount of people who then take the next step of contacting them in a different way, because they don't take orders on Facebook, so you still need to either call or go on the website or WhatsApp or do something else to place an order.
Yeah, so I can have first go. Do you want to? So there's this is a whole industry. As it happens, we as a business have been really, it's a whole industry, and it's 93% of Facebook's revenue is from people buying information about those customers so that they can try and engage them, right, and target them and stuff. We've opted not really to get too engaged in that because we feel there was the question that the colleague who was sitting back there asked about what's legal and what's ethical.
Mm-hmm.
We're just not sure that that...
We're not selling that data to another company. This
right.
is on the company's Facebook page. People
right,
ask
okay.
questions about products and services.
Yeah, yeah.
So how do you get them from asking about the products and services and liking them and being interested in them to actually then purchasing them?
Yeah, yeah.
So not selling the data to other
companies. Got it. Okay, cool. So, I mean, I guess what we would do is we would... trying to go back, you remember in the kind of early part of what I was talking about around committed customers, so the people who do make that transition, and trying to figure out what data can I get, either direct from them in this kind of way, whether it's this sort of platform or directly communicating with them, or what behavior you can do, depending on what capacity your partner has, you can do a bit of, because somebody has consented in their Facebook kind of friend relationship with you, you can do a bit of like scrapes data, gathering of other attributes, kind of behavioral attributes of how people behave on Facebook, and you can build out almost what you call like little dimensions, like we have, like, what are the other things that people do? How do I come up with little DNA profiles of the kinds of customers who do make that transition? That would be the kind of starting point that we would go from and build from there. I guess the other bit is looking at how do you convert advocates, right? So people who have made that jump, how do you design something that is attractive for them to pass backwards and bring those other people? Those would be the two avenues that we would investigate. And what we try and do is try and get some behavioral data on people. And if we could verify it by taking a little sample and asking people, are we reading this right? Is this what drove you, you know, what that motivator for your behavior was? Is that right? And then try and design something back out to it. Yeah. Would you do something different?
Yes, I do. I think what I demonstrated was savvy. I don't know about why this works is actually driven by behavior. Nowadays, everybody's on their phone. Everybody's, if they're not texting, they're on WhatsApp, they're on Facebook Messenger. So I think the way to convert that is to get them interacting with you. I mean, for example, our tool doesn't integrate with Facebook Messenger. It's not yet scaled yet, but you can take somebody who's posted and send on your page, for example, send them a message, and then draw them into a conversation, which can then give them choices. So, you know, if somebody posts on your page, you could automate something that says, thank you for posting. You know, how did you learn about our page? You know, find out where they're coming from, or what did they like to find out about your product? Again, this is interactions driven by the customer, not necessarily you pushing them. You reacting to their action. They contacted you and give them information that can help them, or give them information that allows them to ask more questions, and then you can give them the answer, which might be them buying something or them learning about it.
The last thing I would just say on this is that if anybody has a problem like this, conversion problem, which is a lot of businesses have this in some form or another, one of the things that we see that's really important, especially for small businesses, is to do a little like dry run of like, what's my best not to work working directly with a mobile operator to understand your own customer base. You can, so the parts that you could take out of anything else is if you have a purchase pattern, like, and you have people who are pretty frequency patterns, and this can be around purchasing, anybody who's doing like rural solar electrification, anything that has a regular purchase pattern to it, you can look at people who do like super regular. You can upgrade their income stability. There are different ways that you can build little proxy models, but you do have to have some behavioral source of somebody actually like purchasing something, and they have to be, you know, a customer of yours, so they're getting that. But we're just obviously in a fortunate position of working with anything that is like, you know, investment-based.
I think you just have to ask them. It's sensitive based on how you ask. If I just showed up and asked you about your income, you'll be like, what? But if you build that relationship and trust, you're able to ask those questions. Or if you're able to, it just depends on how you really ask. And again, I think one of the things that we saw is you thinking more about the question and not the logistics of the questions.
Yeah. So from our side, a lot of really good proxies for that in mobile data and mobile money data, which is, again, it's not so that we're working directly with a mobile operator to understand our own customer base. So the parts that you could take out into anything else is if you have a purchase pattern, like, and you have, so mobile is a great thing, like you can buy amounts of any sort and frequency. So, like, obviously, transport, like moving from one place to another implies a different level of income than not people who are pretty frequency patterns. And this can be around purchasing, anybody who's built little proxy models, but you do have to have some behavioral source of somebody actually like purchasing something, and they have to be, you know, a customer of yours, so they are giving you that data. Right? So obviously, in the fortunate position of working with anything that is like, you know, Mesa based or any other mobile platform, or, you know, then you're in a good position for that. So, but the other way is to do kind of sampled stuff. You have to go out and like build a little model and then verify if you have this kind of behavior, does that actually mean your household is in this sort of position, and go out and do some legwork to verify those.
And there also other tools which is able to place people in different buckets based on their lifestyle. From a marketing perspective, marketers think the most important thing is lifestyle, because you might have a high income, but your lifestyle will not let you buy certain things. So if I'm trying to sell you a yacht, because I think you're a millionaire, and this is not your lifestyle, you might not buy it, you know, for example. So there's PPI as a tool that I think a lot of social enterprises use, and then there's also LSM, which is a tool that a lot of marketers use to segment customers.
helpful. Any other people who've got roof, like?
I've just been trying to think through how this would apply to one of those. So we're a table organization in Western Kenya, on the border of Tanzania and Victoria. They aim to decrease rates of FGMs, female genital mutilation, and they want to look at behaviors, attitudes towards that, and then prevalence as well. So I'm interested to hear you, what are your thoughts on something like that using this medium? And then is there any ways to create protection things, like questions to preface that, to maybe enable people to opt out of it and still get paid? And I'm just trying to think through it all myself as well, but it would be great to hear your thoughts.
My experience is that you have to do that somewhere, that has to have a person-to-person sort of element to it. You have to think through in the traditional ways how you create safe spaces and confidentiality, and that's not something that, like, the kind of big data work that we do is suited for. But
so basically what this involves is, for example, there's a new pre-exposure prophylaxis, for example, that is a drug that you take to prevent HIV infection. Or sometimes you have a couple which are both discordant. One is HIV positive, the other one is not positive, but they still want to have children. So you do longitudinal studies about the effectiveness of this pre-exposure prophylaxis, which means you're sending people surveys every week for a defined period. It could be 2 years, 3 years, but it's over a long period because you're trying to find out if people are adhering to the treatment regime. Now, you have situations where in discordant couples, you may have one party is probably could be a commercial sex worker, you know, and so the information they share is very confidential. So there are different ways you can manage this if it's confidential information. One, you can put a level of password so that before I get any questions, you know, there'll be a password that will be involved, and then you also train people to erase the data. If it's SMS, but you also have flash SMS. So the flash SMS does not save the record of this SMS on the phone. So you're able to send a flash SMS and they can respond to the question, but that information is not on the phone, because you do have situations where people actually share their phones. So if you're asking some sensitive information, then you could endanger the person who's participating in this study. So those are some of the ways that we use to deal with those situations.
There's social capital models where you're looking at how connected people are to other people and trying to anchor anybody in the universe of a person at some kind of income proxy level to, you know, in essence, in a way like, you know, if we're mates, you're loaning me some money, and if you know that Jeff, my uncle, happens to be in my network and he's loaded, you're more comfortable lending me money because you know that I've got to, you know, that kind of, you know, kind of relationship based model. There's the mobility stuff. There's situating people in very good granular area community analysis. One of the things that we've seen, one of the things we're really excited about and work that we're doing is not just the understanding of kind of customers and that individual giving them relevance, but being able to under kind of see what, like, anonymized level, but at a community level, what trends there are and how money and economic activity is happening in a community, and being able to therefore develop a risk model that's based on, I don't know your exact circumstance, but you're in this pretty tightly defined community and this is the economic circumstance of that community. So all of those are models that I know we have contributed some to.
And are there any early results on which additional data layers have been more useful from an assessment perspective? Is that social
connection? I have to say, in my experience, I think that it has to do less with what the data points are that people are collecting and more the thoughtfulness and, like, critical thoughtfulness of the people who are interpreting that, the data and the models, and the kind of constantly checking and re-verifying that leads to more success rather than social versus, you know, kind of purchase, you know. Because in essence, the risk calculation you're making in fintech is, are you going to give my money back, right? And on time and that sort of stuff. It has to do with, like, the thoughtfulness. It's almost back to the customer, like, loyalty, customer relevance. How do I engage that person? What are the expectations that are set? What are the, it's I think the
the success of the risk model has much more to do with how thoughtful people engage the person as opposed to the specific data points they're using, to be in my experience. I can't back that up in any like big research study, but that's the experience that we've had. And people who rely totally on, I've got a great model which, you know, shows that you purchase these, you know, like things, if I'm not good at how I set the expectations of the relationship that we're entering into and how I show that I'm thinking about your interests and not just mine, then you're going to have subpar results. That's mine.
Yeah.
Cool.
And okay, let's use a microfinance that uses data, purchases through data to give credit. And we are targeting the base of the pyramid. So my question is, how does your tool, in this situation of those two ways, target, how do you use your tool for people who are not tech savvy? Then how could you get data using your tool for the base
of the pyramid? Resides on a spectrum. There are people who, they have it. Smartphone, they have their laptop, and they can write programs. You know, those are the very tech savvy. And then you have the people on this other spectrum who have a phone and they can only answer phone call. You know, and then you have, okay, I have a phone, I can text, and that's as far as my technology is. So the way the technology works is very simple. So as long as somebody there's a level of literacy, even if you look at literacy itself. It exists on a spectrum. So the way you phrase your questions, you make them very simple. Multiple choice question. Yes or no. You know? Or 0, 10, just give a score. So the way you frame your questions should be such that as long as somebody who can use a phone and text, they should be able to communicate. Or you can just even have open questions. So, at the most basic level, if somebody can use a phone, they can use it, they can text, they can be able to interact with a mobile server.
That does require literacy to use a platform, unless you can get some platform that can do it visually. Like obviously you can have huge depth of communication visually, but usually that person or community that is not literate or not numerate doesn't have technology that allows for that. So if you can introduce that, you know, pictorially you can get information and that, but at that cost, you're then in person.
I think it's part of what you're talking, and I have a background in industrial design engineering and also market research.
Yeah.
So for us, it's extremely interesting to get all the data, and already we've been doing pilots, like getting the info on households, like what's their energy mix. Like it was really hard to get to the data points that are slightly sensitive and people don't.
Yeah.
Exactly know how much they're cooking on, how much charcoal they use, and how much kerosene.
Yeah.
So I was just wondering, I don't have experience working with M-Pesa, and we're going to reach scale at some point, and we're going to get a lot of data, hopefully get a lot of data. How easy is it to work with M-Pesa to get that data to them, or how ethical maybe? Maybe it's a good question to offer that to the group, because I would be extremely interested to also see how households reduce their energy use, how much they're using, when in the day, those kind of things. But I can imagine that like the large scale studies you're doing is only ethical because you're having a huge group or a huge ethical family as a company.
Yeah, basically does have some APIs that you can integrate and get this data. And then again, if the data is from your customers and you're using this data to sell your customers, I don't see any ethical problem. I think the problem comes in between when you take that data and repurpose it or sell it to a different entity. I think that's where the ethical boundaries become problematic.
Or use it to target your customers with somebody else's. Because if you understand household energy consumption, if I sell refrigerators, I want access to your insights, right? And I want to sell my product down your channel.
Yeah.
But that's where you start to get into ethical.
Yeah.
But if you're using that information to serve your customers, understand your customers better, I think I don't see any ethical problem with that.
The other thing, just back to the anonymization thing, I think that obviously it gets statistically better the bigger the sample you are, because if you have like 1,000 customers, you can end up with a profile of somebody's energy usage in a household that actually is singular, so you actually could identify a single person, which once you get up beyond, you know, a few thousand, that could never happen. But I think that as long as you are designing the way that you get insights off your model so that you're never specifically going back and referencing, well, who is that?
Mm-hmm.
That you're doing it with the intent of understanding how you can serve your customers in the relationship that they've agreed to have with you, I think you're on solid ground. The best thing also in our view, and we like try very hard, it's very hard with big companies to do this, but is feedback. Like we have in a couple places been able to do really cool insights work and then convince a company to feed that back in some digestible way to their customer base. And that's like, we think, as you like, our business as yours called Citizen Insight. It's because we believe it's data. We believe that the data fundamentally is the property of the individuals who generate it, even if legally the company is holding it. And so like we have a data charter that, so when we work with people, we say, this is how we engage. And you've got to make those decisions for yourself. And I think there will be a legislative environment in the next 3 to 5 years that will affect that, but being way out ahead of it is much better. Any other questions? Yay. Thanks, everybody, for sticking through a hot, closed, after lunch session about the data. And I didn't see anybody fall asleep. So thanks for giving us your time and attention. It was really nice. If anybody has specific questions and you want to come and talk to either of us, then come and do that now. Cheers.